So moving on to sort of the next idea then with carbon 14 as well, with coal, how does that work as well?
Well, it's a similar problem in that the coal is supposed to be anything from 10 to over 300 million years old, in which case there'd be no carbon 14 left in it if the carbon 14 was there at the beginning. Now, you know, so some people try to explain this by contamination, but we'll get onto that. But coal, we've found carbon 14 in every coal sample that's ever been looked at.
Right. So it's in every single bit of coal, even though it shouldn't be there.
Yeah. So basically, when scientists were developing the carbon 14 dating system many, many decades ago, they wanted a organic sample which they could process, put through the processing that's used for carbon dating, and with something with no carbon 14 present, so they could check how much carbon 14 they were adding during the processing or the preparation of the samples. So they said, oh, we'll go and get some coal because it's obviously got no carbon 14 in it because it's millions of years old. And they got a sample of coal and it had carbon 14 present. And they've been looking ever since for a sample with no carbon 14, and no one's found any. In fact, there was a paper written in the Radiocarbon Journal many years ago now, where they were basically putting out the fact that they've been unable to find any samples of coal with no carbon, with no carbon 14.
And that's so interesting. And so with carbon 14 being in coal, is it just like crazy sort of erratic amounts of carbon 14 in there, or is it looking kind of nice and uniform?
It's fairly consistent, actually, which is, it's consistent with the coal forming from vegetation buried during Noah's flood.
Before we continue, a quick heads up. Stick around to the end of the interview because we'll be giving away a free stream of our award-winning documentary, Evolution's Achilles' Heels. You won't want to miss it. Now back to the interview. And so how does that work then with carbon 14 being in coal and Noah's flood? What does that sort of look like? How would that process work?
Well, here's the thing. When you look at those coal samples, which are supposed to be anything from 10 to 300, over 300 million years old, they all have a similar amount of carbon 14 in them. Now, according to the carbon 14 dating, that's like 30 to 40,000 years old. And that's too old for Noah's flood, but we'll deal with that. And so they, but the fact that there's a consistent amount, similar amount, is consistent with it all being formed by the same process, which would be vegetation buried during Noah's flood and then it's formed coal since then.
But surely, I mean, evolutionists will have an answer for this. What do they commonly say?
Well, there's three go-to attempts to answer this, because you couldn't possibly accept this evidence because otherwise you stop believing in the millions and billions of years. So the first one is contamination. That's the usual go-to. And the idea is that these samples have been contaminated, and they have to be contaminated in recent times. You can remember that carbon 14 would all decay away in something like 50 or 60,000 years. You don't be able to measure any, certainly 100,000 years, you can't measure anything. There's nothing there. So consequently, the contamination has to be recent, and all these samples that are supposed to be over 300 million years or the diamonds can't be contaminated, so that rules that out with diamonds. So the contamination thing, though, is checked in the process of carbon dating. So in the laboratory, they check what's called carbon 13, carbon 12 ratio. Sounds technical, and it is, but why do they do that? They do that because if the carbon 14 comes from organic material from plants, which all of it has to, because photosynthesis locks it into food and then things eat the plants. And so the animal that eats the plant becomes has the same carbon 14 that the plant had. And similar to algae in the ocean, and fish eat the algae and they get the carbon 14 from the algae. It's all from photosynthesis. But the different plants and algae have a different enzymes which take up the CO2, the carbon dioxide, and they discriminate against something which is not carbon 12. So carbon 12 is a normal carbon dioxide, carbon 14 is radioactive carbon dioxide, and carbon 13, though, is it's also different to carbon 12, but it's slightly heavier. And the enzyme discriminates against the carbon 13 carbon dioxide. Mm-hmm. And the carbon 13 carbon 12 ratio is constant. It doesn't decay like the carbon 14 does. And yes. So you can look at the ratio of carbon 13 to carbon 12, and you can see that the organic matter that's being checked for carbon 14 hasn't been contaminated. It's actually from plants. It's actually, in fact, there's two different sorts of plants in terms of their chemistry of photosynthesis. You can even tell which sort of plant it is or whether it's algae.
Right, yes.
So is it contamination? No, clearly not contamination. That's checked for in the actual process of carbon dating.
Right. So number one, is it contaminated? You can test for that and the answer is no.
No, not contaminated.
Not contaminated. Well, there's two more options. What are the other two options?
So the second option is uranium can decay to produce some carbon 14. So the normal uranium decay chain takes you through to lead.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a side chain with a tiny, tiny percentage of it can actually go to carbon 14.
Okay.
So the idea is that there's contamination or small amounts of uranium in the actual samples, in the vegetation, which became coal or whatever, which has produced the carbon 14. Now, again, it has to happen in the last 50,000 years. So if the,
right.
if this happened, you know, a million years ago, it's not going to help.
Doesn't matter anymore.
And here's the problem. It's such a tiny amount of carbon 14 produced by the uranium decay that for it to produce enough carbon 14 to be significant, to be measurable, to give you a carbon 14 age,
mm-hmm.
The sample would have to be 99% uranium.
Right, and we're pretty sure when we're dealing with coal,
it's not coal, uranium. It's not uranium.
It's not uranium.
Exactly right.
So
that doesn't work.
We have a bit of a problem there then. So it can't be contaminated. We know it's not contaminated. We can test that. We know it's not 99% uranium, so it's not producing carbon 14 through that method. What is the final option then?
The third one is that the normal process of production of carbon 14 in the atmosphere is that a nitrogen 14 is hit by a neutron in a cosmic ray type of thing in the upper atmosphere, and the neutron's absorbed by the nitrogen and produces carbon 14. So that's how carbon 14 is normally produced.
Mm-hmm.
The idea is that nitrogen in the vegetation, which has become coal,
mm-hmm.
had some nitrogen in it, and nearby some radioactive decay of other material produced neutrons which bombarded the nitrogen and made it into nitrogen carbon 14. That's how you got the carbon 14 in the sample. It has to happen. All has to happen recently. It's no good at it happening millions of years ago, and has to happen the last 50,000 years. And what's the chances of that happening?
Pretty low.
Very, very low. And it would produce such a tiny amount, it wouldn't be significant. So, and also, if this was an explanation for the carbon 14 present, you would expect the amount of carbon 14 to be proportional to the amount of nitrogen in the sample.
Yes.
Not the case.
Not the case.
Again. In fact, as we said earlier, the coal samples all have a similar amount of carbon 14. But there's a huge yes. range of nitrogen levels in these things. So it doesn't explain it at all.
Right. So we've got three options, two of which are sort of outright wrong, and one that would be, you would have to have a very specific scenario for it to work, and it's not looking very likely. So overall, there's no real explanation for this that has come forward that has been compelling.
There's no explanation that works. In fact, I had a meeting with a bunch of scientists in Adelaide 2023, and they were very resistant of the idea the Earth could be young. And when I brought up the question of carbon dating and how it's strong evidence against their belief in millions and billions of years, they were very resistant of the idea. In fact, they're a bit hostile. But their go-to was contamination.
Yes.
Contamination. And I explained how the carbon 14 dating system works and how it's checked for in the process of processing the samples.
Mm.
And the most vocal opponent of what I was talking about went very silent. And right. he privately emailed me later and said that's very powerful evidence against millions and billions of years.
Mm-hmm.
So the people who, you know, some of the comments on the internet about our material on carbon dating have put forward, oh, you don't understand carbon dating. It's residual, which means it's contamination. These people making these statements actually don't understand the carbon dating process because it's checked for in the way in which the samples are dealt with in the lab for carbon dating.
So this is a big thorn in the side, the carbon 14 problem, for those people who think this is a long, long period of time, billions of years, natural processes, where this sort of doesn't really line up particularly well with that entire idea.
It should be a thorn in their side. But they give trite answers. But if they go into it and actually research it, it is a huge problem for the millions of years story. A huge problem.
How much time would that actually shave off of their sort of time scale if what you're saying is true?
Well, you think about the diamonds, 1 to 3 billion years. And if they're dated at the dating is 40,000 years. That takes off billions of years of time.
We're working in the tens of thousands of years then, aren't we?
Yeah. This gets rid of billions of years. I mean, the coal, as we said, is 10 to 300 million years old, and it brings it all into last 40,000 years or so, according to their own dating. This gets rid of deep time, you know, it effectively gets rid of deep time.
Well, Don, we've talked about a lot of failed predictions today, 6 to be exact. We were aiming for 5, but we got one extra here. It's been phenomenally interesting. And I hear that there's actually a resource that you have, a documentary that also is talking about these same topics. Do you want to tell us a bit about that?
Yes, indeed. Evolution's Achilles' Heels. It's all about failed predictions of evolution, actually, and many more than 5 or 6. This is actually 15 PhD scientists were involved in producing this documentary, all speaking within their own fields and things. And it's powerfully done with illustrations and animations. And I think people would find it very, very helpful to realize that evolution, cosmic evolution, is a failed prediction. It's a failed theory, and it should be discarded. So this is something that I'd highly recommend.
And we are actually going to make this available as a free stream, and the link is in the description if you want to go check that out. Thanks, Don, for your time. It has been an absolute pleasure to hear you talk about the failed predictions of cosmic evolution. I've had a great time, and I hope that everyone watching has also had just as great a time as I have. Look forward to doing further interviews with you later.
Thanks, James. Thank you.